Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim and Assalamu alaikum Pakistan. Welcome back to the Common Voice Show with your host, Professor Syed Hussain Haider. It's good to see all of you. And today, in this wintry evening, we have two amazing guests. One of our guests is from Islamabad, and the other one is from Europe, Vienna, Austria. We have with us today Aftab Shoaib, who is working with the UNODC, the United Nations Office for Drugs and Crime Office in Islamabad. And we also have with us Florian Lair, who is working with the UNODC headquarters in Vienna, Austria. First of all, I would like Aftab Shoaib Saab to give a brief overview of his experiences and of his professional career.
Thank you very much, Haider Saab. It's been 30 years. I am working with the adult learning, and basically I joined UNODC in 2011 as a training manager of one of the flagship initiative of UNODC country office Pakistan, which is e-learning, basically distant learning initiative. And then I switched over to criminal justice and legal reforms program as senior training and development officer. So it's been 10-11 years working with UNODC and interacting with the criminal justice and legal reforms actors in the country. It includes police, prosecutors, judiciary, and prisons.
Just amazing, Aftab Shoaib. You've been doing so much, and again, institutionalizing all of these mechanisms and processes on behalf of UNODC. We are very fortunate to have with us Florian Lair from the UNODC headquarters in Vienna, Austria. It must be very cold nowadays. I can understand it's freezing cold right now. But we would like to hear your professional experiences.
Thank you so much. My name is Florian. I am a crime prevention and criminal justice officer in the corruption and economic crime branch of the United Nations Office on Drugs and Crime in Vienna, Austria. And I coordinate projects in the area of business integrity, so anti-corruption in the private sector. We currently work in around 16 countries, and we interact with a broad spectrum of stakeholders, so mainly private sector, so business representatives, but also public officials, so government representatives, universities, civil society, and other stakeholders that are relevant in the area of business integrity. And our work revolves around the United Nations Convention Against Corruption, which is the only legally binding anti-corruption instrument globally. And we basically promote the implementation of the convention. We support state parties in implementing the convention. And our work on business integrity, so on anti-corruption in the private sector, is an important part of that mission.
No, thank you so much. Very interesting. So, Mr. Aftab, you're talking about UNODC, and you basically shared your own contribution. But UNODC Pakistan must be doing a lot more. So could you share with us its major interventions and initiatives in Pakistan?
Yeah, it's a very interesting question, in a sense that very less of Pakistan people, they know about UNODC, because mostly we are being overshadowed by the big UN agencies, which are working in the public and private sector. We have a very special sort of a mandate working with the government agencies. And I mean, we are a very small office. It's not that big. Our presence is only in Islamabad, but we are working from Islamabad in different provinces and cities also. So UNODC is basically working on three, four major mandates. In that, we have the border management and transnational organized crime. Then we have criminal justice and legal reforms program. And then we have drugs demand reduction. And recently, in the third country program, which we have signed with the government of Pakistan, we are working on counterterrorism also. So these are the four pillars on which the country office Pakistan is working. And we have a 5 years country program, which will be terminating somewhere in 2025. Till that time, we'll be contributing in these areas, which I have mentioned. So you already see, while working with these in this mandate, we are basically going for the legislative reforms and the institutional policy reforms. We provide the technical education of all the stakeholders which fall under these this mandate. And then we are also working in the human resource development, from which I belong to that team, which is working for the human resource development and especially the adult learning in these institutes. And then we are also contributing, once we talk about the operational capacity building, providing the equipment or things like that. And the fourth pillar in that, once we are talking about UNODC country program Pakistan, is the carrying out surveys, carrying out the workshops, seminars, once we are talking about these institutes. So in all, I mean, the mandate works with about 21 agencies of government of Pakistan, because once you talk about the border management and transnational organized crime, then the stakeholders are different, like FIA, customs, and all those agencies which are looking after the borders. And mainly they are working on the drug trafficking and human trafficking and migrant smuggling. So once we talk about the criminal justice and legal reforms sub-program, then we are talking about the police, the prosecution department, the prison department, the judiciary, all the actors which fall under the criminal justice. And basically, it's also geographically very diverse. We are working in Punjab also. We have the presence in Balochistan also. Then once we talk about the drug demand reduction, we are working with ANF, in which we are trying to, whatever drugs being consumed here for the rehab of those who are addicts, and working with the HIV and AIDS addicts also. So mainly in this, we are working with the ANF, Anti-Narcotics Force. And now we are working with the counterterrorism also, as I mentioned. For the next 5 years, we will be working in that sphere also. And in that, we are working with the NECTA. Main, our partner is NECTA. And then the CTDs of police in different provinces. So this is all the four pillars and the areas where we are working, which I have just mentioned.
Very, very diverse portfolio. And it's just amazing that UNODC is working in so many areas, but it's not commonly known to people. Whenever I've been mentioning UNODC, they say, which UN agency? But if you look at the substance of contribution into the governance structure of Pakistan, then your contribution as an organization is phenomenal.
Yeah, you're very right, because it's a very specialized sort of contribution which we are providing to the government of Pakistan. And we have, talking about few initiatives where we are interacting with the private sector or the NGOs. Otherwise, most of our bulk of the work is with the government agencies.
Yes, absolutely.
And the visibility is very, you see, we have to be very careful once we are talking about the visibility, that whatever we are doing with these government agencies. So we have to come to terms whatever the government of Pakistan policy is regarding on these subjects. Mm-hmm. So that's why the people are not very much aware. But as far as the contribution, as you very rightly mentioned, that it's huge. And these are the areas which really requires our support, because they are the policy implementing partners. So that's why our work is very important.
Excellent, excellent. Florian, because we are very fortunate that you're visiting Pakistan for the first time.
Yes.
I hope you have a very interesting, memorable and hospitable stay over here in Pakistan. We take advantage of that presence of yours from the headquarters. So you again are doing so many projects. You mentioned some of them, and you talked about the Global Integrity Education Project also. Could you give us a global overview of this project?
Mm-hmm. Of course. Thank you for the question. So maybe first to start out, when we think about corruption, we all know that it has a negative impact on society. But it also has a very negative impact on the private sector corruption, because it makes doing business expensive, slow, it distorts competition, and it basically acts as an additional tax on doing business. And I think we really have to consider that, because if the economic situation is difficult, then of course businesses don't want to have additional money that they need to spend. So I think the private sector has a strong interest in strengthening integrity. And we of course have a number of approaches of how this can be done. One of them is the Global Integrity Education Project that is active in Pakistan, where we really try to tackle the issue of corruption at its root stage, and where we try to work with universities to develop modules for students that seek to promote integrity, transparency, accountability, all those values that are so important in the students, because we know that those students, they will later move to positions in companies, but also in the government, where they will be actually leaders. So we really try to target the students at an early stage. So once they move to their future positions, they can act as agents of change and really promote integrity, ethics, etc. in their institutions. And just to give a bit of an overview of the Global Integrity Education Project, so the project is not only active in Pakistan, but also in Mexico and Kenya. So three very diverse countries, very unique countries. But we also see that this approach has a lot of potential, that the issue of corruption can be similar in different scenarios, in different contexts. And it does make sense to work with youth, because youth simply has this potential and also the enthusiasm to really start creating change. So I think it's a really rewarding approach. And what we, of course, try to achieve in the next stage is to carry over the changes that we've made in the universities, so the modules that we've developed, the education, to the companies, making use of the students that have been trained, to really also start this process of training, of capacity building in the companies to have some positive impact on integrity.
Inspiring, I would say. Inspiring, and again, having very far-reaching consequences. Talking about the future leadership and how that leadership can be nurtured to be more responsible, more diligent, more focused, determined, and more progressive in their decision-making and in the approach towards governance and also life as a whole. Mr. Aftab, again, seeing that you are the implementing, UNODC office over here is the implementing arm for the Global Integrity Education Project. How do you see, because you have such a diverse and such a vast experience of training, how do you see integrity training emerging in Pakistan?
I mean, it's excellent experience as far as the Pakistan country is concerned, because I mean, working with the, as referring back to my previous response to the question which you asked, I mean, working with the adults and the, especially the professionals, talking about the police, ANF, customs, we are working on their ethics training or the behavior change training. So this is for the first time it was, in Pakistan, that we are interacting with the youth, other than the professionals which are already doing their job and they are in service. So it's really very heartening. And it was, for me as an individual, I always used to think about that, why not to start from the grassroots level? Why try to change the people once they are in that system, rather than why not to invest on the very beginning? So it's very important, as Florian mentioned, that it's not only they'll be joining as leaders in the private sector, but also in the public sector. So, I mean, preparing that nursery and then shifting and transforming them towards their professional life is very important. So this is one of the very good experience or the best practice we could have in Pakistan long ago. But now, okay, we have started off and it is going to prove its results. The second thing is that the bringing these all stakeholders together was, something which is a success. Normally what used to happen was in universities, the ethics curriculum was there, but these students were having that in silo. They were taking on the theory and lectures rather than interacting with the business community or the public sector where there will be afterwards going. So this initiative has an added advantage, a comparative advantage, once we talk about these champions interacting with these business enterprises and with the CEOs and the already existing leadership. So for them also, I mean, it is as the change agent, they take it as a responsibility that they are going to bring that change which we all desire once we are talking about the ethics, accountability, and oversight mechanism. So for Pakistan, I mean, it was such a good experience and involving the academia. I mean, that strengthened the complete the arrangement which was planned and which was desired. And it worked out that the all these three stakeholders coming together at a different stage, not at the very beginning, first we invested on the academia, the professors giving them the best practices, the international best practices on this important subject. And then preparing the students, involving them, engaging them through these academia persons, and then taking it a step further and interacting with the business enterprises. So that that thing was, I mean, it can be a case study for other initiatives where different agencies have an overlapping mandate or somewhat working on the same objective. So this is a very successful model, where you start preparing one institute and then, I mean, changing the baton to the next. And then, so this is what is required once we are talking about learning or once we are talking about implementation of the best practices, whether it is ethics, whether it is any other technical subject we are talking about. So it was a very good experience. And hopefully, I mean, it is going to sustain. Because of the reason that everybody has seen, all the stakeholders have seen the potential in it, that if you invest less on this, you are going to have you will save from the troubles which you can foresee once we are talking about unethical behaviors or corruption going on in the industries and the increase in the overhead charges once we are talking about some inquiries going on or something of going on. So this is the time where we invest at the very initial stage and hope for the best.
Excellent. So Florian, building upon Aftab Shoaib's wonderful narration of how things are moving about in this Global Integrity Education Project, how do you see the youth promoting business integrity on a global level? Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Yeah, I believe really that the youth has a critical role in promoting integrity, simply because a large part of society is young, are young people, and they really have a shared enthusiasm, and they also want to inspire change and basically improve society. And I think we can really capitalize on that and empower them to be these agents of change, to be ethics ambassadors. Not only in their future workplaces, but also in their private life, to communicate about it, to speak up if they see that something is going wrong, and to basically create this global movement for integrity. So I really see that youth has a critical role in that. And I think what we also need to mention is that the lecturers and the universities have been of great support, because the universities really believe in values such as transparency, accountability, integrity. And the lecturers, I mean, it's just been astonishing. We've seen phenomenal lecturers that have really the capacity to also empower young people in creating change, in promoting integrity, in behaving in an ethical way. And I really believe that the universities are well placed to promote such values.
I just want to add on what Florian said, and I mean, specific to Pakistan, that, you know, we have a youth bulge. I mean, most of the people, they are of the age where they start learning towards the new subject or the best practices. So being Pakistan, being one of that country, I mean, to invest on the youth is going to bring the change, mm-hmm. because of the reason that the The program will expand more because of the target audience having the bulk. So this is also one of the reasons that Pakistan, I think, was selected because we have more people joining these enterprises and these public sectors. So that is one of the reasons that we have to invest in the youth to bring that change which we all desire.
Well, just before the show, while we were having coffee, we were having this discussion that how this recession and these troubling times are going to make it very challenging for the youth, especially with lesser opportunities, maybe at a national level and even at a global level. We are seeing a global recession coming in. And in these circumstances, how do you foresee this initiative of promoting integrity and ensuring that there is more self-accountability moving forward? And what are the practical implications of all of this?
Sir, my experience working with the, I mean, the professionals also and whatever interaction I had with the youth also, I mean, today our youth is more, they are more information they have about this unethical practices and accountability, the importance, and whatever the previous generation, mine and yours, I mean, we were not that concerned about such like practices. But the youth today, they are very mindful of that. I mean, if not one of the, not the top, one of the top subject, once we they are interacting among themselves, they are talking about this ethics and this behavior change they have to bring, the accountability and oversight mechanisms. I mean, once we are talking about the freshly graduate going to a professional organization or a business entity, he has that mind who wants to bring that change, whatever was going on previously. So I think this will have the effect to some extent to the very start. But then, I mean, the progress can be made and they have that set targets for them and they really want to work for, and they don't want to listen to this thing that after they're joining, the things are at the moving at the same pace and things like that. So they are coming with the motivation because they have heard a lot about this, that this is going to bring the change which we all desire for.
Inshallah. We're looking forward to that, especially with all of these initiatives being taken by UNODC, which are very futuristic in context and outlook.
If I just may add, so I believe that at least with this Global Integrity Education Project, we've trained more than 28,000 students globally in Mexico, Kenya, and Pakistan, with the help of the participating lecturers. And when I meet the students, the feeling that I get is really that they are so motivated to implement integrity, to promote ethics, that I'm very confident that this movement will get only stronger in the coming years. And I also believe that there's a strong business case for integrity. We know that companies that act with integrity, that promote ethical practices, they are more successful in the longer term. They have more motivated employees. They do great at innovation. So I do believe there's a strong potential also in promoting integrity, not only to have a more fair and equal and just society, but also to have a clean and stronger private sector that can promote sustainable development.
Excellent. So just as a follow-up question with you, Florian, you earlier mentioned the ethics ambassadors of UNODC. First, what are the objectives of these ethics ambassadors? What will they be doing? And then what are your expectations also from these ethics ambassadors in the years to come?
Mm-hmm. So maybe just as a bit of a background, when we designed this Global Integrity Education Project together with the universities and with the private sector, we did realize that there was not a lot of interaction between the private sector and the universities on anti-corruption and integrity. So that's basically the potential that we would like to realize. And so our first step was to develop the university modules, to train the lecturers on how to teach the students. And now we are basically at this stage where the students that have been empowered, that have developed a certain ethical mindset, go into their workplaces, go into the companies. And that's where this Ethics Ambassadors program comes into play, where we basically seek to select the students that are the champions that have gone through the modules to be ethics ambassadors in their future workplaces, in the companies, but also in the public sector, to act as these agents of change that we've been talking about. So to basically promote integrity, to come to the companies with a fresh mindset, but also with fresh ideas, because it's so easy when you've been working in a company for a long time to just adopt the practices that have been in place. But the students, since they come freshly out of university, they have this opportunity to say, oh, the way this is done is actually not the best way. We could handle this in a different way. And we want to empower them to A, know what is good and what should be done, and to B, to be able to communicate this to their supervisors, but also to the company as a whole, to basically improve the corporate practices that are in place. And to supplement this entire approach, we've developed training for companies, a so-called on-the-job training that is based on the university modules, which is also something new, something that we have not done before, to take university teaching materials to companies. But that's basically what we're doing. So we have created a training program for company representatives to basically give the companies this push and to also support the ethics ambassadors, so the students that will go to the companies in creating this change.
So you basically have this multifaceted approach whereby the identified stakeholders are all interlinked with each other and contributing at different levels. So that there's more reinforcement of concept, and based upon that reinforcement, it is also practically rolled out and actually implemented, and does not only remain as a philosophy. Mm-hmm. It's really fascinating, because usually what happens is that such concepts are just vague concepts, and people know about them, but they don't implement them in their own personal or professional lives. So,
I just want to add whatever you are saying is, I mean, one of the success or the salient is basically the integration of this in the system, rather than giving a one-time sort of a arrangement. I mean, the success was, as Florian was mentioned, that universities acceptability to carry on or to carry forward, even once the UNODC is no more there on the project. So they have integrated in their curriculums. Yes. So that is, I think, the success that in times to come, even once the UNODC doesn't fall back to them, they have their now internal system mechanisms working and talking about these best practices and talking about interacting with the private enterprises and the public organizations which come in the public sector. So this has become a practice now. So the sustainability is coming through that integration in their curriculums. That is going to help, which is going to be a key to success of this program, further rolling out in years to come.
Well, this is the first time I'm hearing all of this. And it's just amazing how you've really thought out the whole process and integrated its different components. Joining the different pieces of the puzzle to make a beautiful picture emerge at the end of the day, which would be self-sustainable and self-running. And the word that you used, again, the movement which is emerging again, is something which would bring about a sea change, a transformation in the corporate culture and in different societies also around the world. With these three countries basically working as pilot countries, and we can hope and pray that you take this forward, and after the pilot countries, you expand upon the learnings that have been garnered over these years with all of these stakeholders. It's just amazing. And just listening to you, and I hope our audience also tends to get motivated and inspired and move forward and support this whole movement. But I have a question which either both of you can answer or one of you can answer, that's your prerogative, is that nowadays we see a splurge of social media. There's a lot of negative talk on social media. This is this is bad on social media, that is bad on social media. Why don't we hear these ideas on social media? Why don't we have different platforms where these ideas, these examples, these case studies which you are talking about, the different discussions or different dialogues which are going on, they are shared? Because the youth is very much inclined towards the different social media platforms. So what is your take on that? And I'd first ask Mr. Aftab and then also you, Florian.
Yeah, specifically talking about Pakistan, I mean, this is the all-important discussion nowadays going on, the expansion of the social media and the impact that social media is creating. I mean, as far as specifically talking about this project, we remain very successful. I mean, we are talking about a very small numbers once we are talking about the universities, or once we are talking about the students engaged or the academia engaged, once we are talking about the complete country, and then the business community, very less number. But the success was that we tried to expand it through the social media. Once we talk about the Instagram, once we talk about the Facebook, once we talk about different other social media mediums, we tried as UNODC Country Office Pakistan that this should be expanded to all those universities and students and in business enterprises where we couldn't reach out because of our limitations. Through this, I mean, we had a special communication officer with us as a consultant who was giving us advices that how to use this media, how to make the web stories, how to tell about the different turning points once we are talking about the complete initiative. So we were very mindful once we are talking about the using of the social media. And I think that was one of the reasons of success. I mean, because then the people start coming to us and they started joining us. I mean, especially I'll be talking about the business enterprises. I mean, this is a learning for them also. I mean, we are talking a lot about the youth learning, but the business entities, they learned a lot from it, that their sensitization about the subject, the advocacy we want to carry out with them, they're coming forward with another new ideas which we were not having in our storyline or are in our storyboard. So they also come out with the practical implementation of few problems. So, I mean, talking about this, I mean, once we started off, I mean, we were very few and we were trying to put our all out effort. And that expansion, while using the social media, that brought people to us, whether we are talking about the universities, whether we are talking about the academia people, whether we are talking about the youth joining this initiative. I mean, we then started receiving applications to join this good initiative, and same is the case with the business entities. So the effective use of social media was also a key to the success, to taking people on board, and they were coming while having seen the potential in this initiative.
So you basically created a snowball effect.
Yeah, it was a Demony's effect, that people, you know, after listening from through social media or during interactions on the social media. So it was very easy then. I mean, that was the first challenge once I started off this with program. I was thinking that, okay, I'll take few universities with me. I'll try to convince few students to come to this in their boot camps, or once they are free from their the core education curriculum. So I'll have this challenge. And then what to talk about the industry. I mean, it was very difficult. It's something unique for a country like Pakistan.
Yes.
But the use of social media, giving it a visibility and a very technical sort of a visibility where you focus whatever is buying in for the industry, not for the universities. And while focusing with the universities, not for the industries. So things like that, once we were successful, so that created that we have such a huge number of stakeholders now on board. And they have integrated also, as I mentioned. Absolutely. So that was also through convincing through the social media that this program has a potential. It can be used in times to come. And this is going to save you money rather than you are thinking about investing in it. I mean, once you start about the unethical practices or corruption, I mean, the money is going out and you are not very aware of. Yeah. So why not to prevent rather to respond? So this program is giving us that drive also that we can have it before it happens. Mm-hmm. So proactively interacting and things like that. So social media, I mean, that was one of the strong points once we are talking about rolling out of this initiative.
Excellent. And so Florian, your take on this?
And even beyond social media, we, of course, try to raise awareness for the topic of anti-corruption in the private sector. And for the project specifically, we've also developed a so-called UNODC Business Integrity Portal, where we provide all of the relevant information, so the university modules, but also other information, background documents, publications, etc., that basically students, but also lecturers or businesses can download and can use in their operations. And maybe what's also interesting, we've been even expanding from the project itself. So for example, in Mexico, we will for the first time have a hackathon specifically for youth, where we try to realize their potential. And of course, one of the key questions has always been, how can we communicate more about anti-corruption? How can we create this global movement? So we do see that the students are very interested in exchange, that there's a big need to also understand what is the problem exactly. And there's also this individualist approach of what can I do to contribute to promoting integrity, to fighting corruption. And we, of course, try to empower the youth to basically and nurture what's already within them and to realize their potential in this respect.
And here I thank you also, because this is also one of the event which is going to promote whatever we are talking about once it is going on air. So this is also the use of social media and the mediums. So I thank you also.
Thank you so much for the organization coming over to Loha and also Florian, because we are going to have another talk also on the same subject.
Excellent.
So we are going to carry forward these panel discussions on this subject of integrity and Global Integrity Education Project to see how the different stakeholders are contributing and also learning from this particular project in the coming weeks ahead. There's so much more to unravel, and it's really interesting listening to both of you. But because we have paucity of time, and definitely, like I said, we're going to have some more talk shows related to this particular project and also to UNODC and its initiatives. I would just request you, as a finale, to give a message to the youth of Pakistan.
Thank you very much, Haider Saab. I mean, this is going to be very important once I'm talking to the youth. I am very much assured that they are mindful of their responsibilities, and especially once we talk about the oversight and accountability mechanisms. But my advice will be only this, that the change, once we talk about, it comes through time. It cannot be abrupt. It has to be from one to two to many. So they don't have to get frustrated. They have to be within the system. They have to bring change. So it will be slow. Till the time they will remain steadfast and steady. So they'll be able to bring that change, which we all desire.
Thank you so much, Mr. Aftab, for this very far-reaching message to the youth of Pakistan. And I hope and pray that over the years, they tend to implement and bring into action your words. Florian, again, it has been such a wonderful experience meeting you. And it's good to know that you are in the historical city of Lahore. And we hope that you have a very memorable stay over here. And again, you see not only the historical dimension, not only the cultural dimension, but the very famous food and cuisine of the city of Lahore. You gave us a very unique perspective globally, and again how UNODC is currently and in the future will be interfacing with different countries and different societies, trying to promote a global culture of integrity. Because we are going to have a series of panel discussions on this subject with UNODC and its stakeholders. Now, I would just like to request you for your final words and also a message directly to the youth of Pakistan from a global perspective. So, Florian.
Thank you so much. So indeed, for me, it's been really inspiring to be here in Pakistan and to see how interested the youth is in this topic of anti-corruption and integrity in the private sector, how much they've benefited from the business guest lectures that we've organized, and how enthusiastic they are about the topic. And this really gives me a lot of hope, but also a lot of confidence, because I believe that this movement can really make a change. And my message to the youth of Pakistan is that every single person makes a difference. You can make a difference, you can carry this forward, and I can only encourage you to keep promoting integrity, to act as actors of change in your future workplaces, in your private life, and to help us so that we can all jointly build a better society, build a better future for each and every one of us.
Thank you. And again, the youth will take this message forward. Mr. Aftab Shoaib, thank you so much. It was just wonderful having you on this show. And
thank
we look
you.
Forward to have more opportunities to share these wonderful ideas that you talked about.
Thank
today.
You.
Florian, again, welcome to Lahore. And thank you so much
thank
for
you.
Joining us on the Common Talk. And inshallah, in the next visit also, we'll arrange another panel discussion for you in the coming days. So thank you so much. And we have this small tradition to end it with Pakistan
Zindabad.
Thank you.